Hey, hi there. This is especially weird today talking to a camera out in public. It's weird enough at home when it's just me and the cats, but I wanted to be here today at the Uptown Bar. It's Wednesday, October 28th, and as many of you know, this establishment is going to be closing its doors within a few days here, October 31st. And I've got a story that I've been wanting to tell for quite a while, and I pictured myself telling it in the exact place where it happened. So I'm really glad I made it in here before the close and actually got the exact booth where it happened. Little story of an exchange I had with the late, great Bob Stinson. Everybody's got stories about him doing crazy things and being Bob, but actually I had something that relates to music, believe it or not. But anyway, so for those of you that don't know the Replacements, please go look them up. They were a huge influence on me, you know, in many ways. I was lucky enough to be exposed to them like in early high school, and they, you know, I was a kid who was learning classical guitar and taking music pretty seriously and, you know, trying to get as good as I could at my instrument. You know, but I was also a teenager and I had some angst and, you know, I liked punk music and, but I also liked jazz and a large part of why I was attracted to the Replacements was that I came across them like on a punk compilation, but I realized that they really stood out as, you know, as a band that took music and music history, I don't want to say seriously, but they knew their history, and they obviously had, you know, they enjoyed playing their music, their instruments, and they enjoyed being a, you know, a good band when they were a good band. They also enjoyed getting drunk, and, you know, it was kind of a hit or miss thing, but anyway, could go on a long time about the Replacements. The other thing is wherever they were from, if I hadn't known that they were from South Minneapolis, they would still be one of my favorite all-time bands, and just to find out that they were local and they hung out the same place as I wasn't hanging out when I was 14, but later on, you know, and I would see them on the street, you know, I heard them rehearsing through a concrete wall a couple times, and anyway, that made a lot of impact on me too, just to know that, you know, all the geniuses of the world were not in Los Angeles or New York, but that there was some really brilliant stuff going on right in town here. Anyway, so I had been into the Replacements for several years already, and I when I started playing in the bars in Minneapolis, it was like late 80s, 88 was my first bar gig, with the Wraparounds, and sorry, I'm rambling. I didn't have time to rehearse this, so I'm just going to pretend that you're a very quiet and patient friend here. Anyway, I ended up playing like in 1990, 91 with a band called Second Nature, and the bass player in that band was Carlene Stinson, who was married to Bob Stinson, who, if you don't know, is the founding guitar player in the Replacements and the oldest member, kind of the gang leader in some ways. Gotta be curious what's up on Wikipedia about Bob Stinson. But anyway, he passed away in 95, I believe it was. But I met him first in 1990, and that in and of itself was kind of a big event. I remember the first time I met him, we were talking guitar, and he told me his favorite guitar player was Steve Howe from Yes, which I just could not believe. But then seconds later, I realized, wow, yeah, you know, I mean, he is kind of like Steve Howe, except not as disciplined, and yeah, I don't know, it made some kind of weird sense. But anyway, we were playing with this band, Second Nature. We were playing at the Uptown here. Carlene was the bass player, and Jeff Jara, the drummer. Trevor Lettman was the guitarist and singer and songwriter. And I was pretty excited because it was the first gig that Bob came to, the first time Bob was actually going to get to hear me play. And he was sitting right here in this very booth. And you know, I was up there on stage kind of watching for response, and I was flattered he was just paying attention to me. But anyway, the set went pretty well. And afterwards, of course, I came up to him, you know, sat down next to him here, and I was a little shy about it, but I really wanted to know what he thought, seeing that he was one of my musical heroes. And he said, hope I can get this right, I can't possibly imitate him, but he said, yeah, man, I like your playing, you know, real melodic, real nice, but you gotta wipe out more. And I was like, wipe out? And I think he could tell that I didn't know what exactly he meant by that. But he said, you know, wipe out, like, you know, you're playing something real nice and melodic and sweet, and then you go chromatic, and you just kind of get crazy, and then you land back on a sweet note. And I was like, oh, yeah, okay, wiping out. And I realized that was a big part of his genius, that he was a disciplined player, I think, probably for a long time, and he had, you know, he had technical chops and knew what he was doing, but he, you know, his beauty was when he wiped out and when he kind of gave over control of what he was doing. And it's just really stuck with me, and I've heard that in more and more music since then too. I've realized that what he's referring to is something that jazz players do, blues players, really just anytime you hear somebody kind of go beyond what they totally have control over, that's how I interpret it. Coltrane, for sure. I mean, I think he was so amazingly technically proficient that it was kind of hard for him to wipe out, but later in his career, yep, thank you. Awesome. That's a good-looking sound. Yeah, anyway, even Coltrane, I think, you know, part of his lifelong pursuit was probably to kind of learn how to wipe out, even though he was such a trained, schooled musician. You know, in the end, he was really trying to get to a place that was kind of beyond his control, and I think he took it in a real spiritual sense, that, you know, he was trying to let God play, or however he interpreted it at the time. I think of it as kind of a Zen thing, just giving up, giving over control. But yeah, I hear it a lot with the electric guitar too, because there's so many things, so many factors involved that you don't have control over, feedback. Anyway, it's something that to me is really exciting, and I love love that image. Bob just kind of tilted his head back, like on the back cover of Sorry Ma, Forgot to Take Out the Trash, and he was just like, yeah, you know, and I got it. So, yeah, and since then I've tried, you know, to incorporate that into what I do, but it's a challenge, especially when you have taken your instrument seriously and learned all the scales and, you know, studied classical music, which generally has no room for that. And I started doing it with Second Nature, and they came up with the term, they called it going to Idaho, which I like. They're like, you know, encouraging me to go to Idaho more often. But anyway, I think, you know, part of the trick too is, how do you get back, you know, when you go to Idaho and when you wipe out. You know, unfortunately, I think a lot of people, including Bob, I didn't know him well, but I, you know, certainly sounds like he kind of wiped out, you know, in many ways in life. And if you use drugs or alcohol to get there, that's a perilous path, and a lot of people don't make it back from there. But to me, it's it's a really spiritual endeavor to me to be able to kind of incorporate that in your playing, to kind of let go and not be in total control over everything you're doing. But I also want to do it in a way that I can return. So I just wanted to tell you that little story, and I just wanted to get in here to the Uptown. This might be my last time here, and I'm really glad the booth was open so I could show you the exact spot where Bob told me about wiping out. Gosh, I guess that's it for now. Hope you enjoy it, and we'll see you around.